It's a pleasure to be here. I cannot thank the organizers because I'm one of them. So instead, I'll thank my stars that I'm having the privilege of participating in this conference in honor of Nagaraj. He's a wonderful person. I don't want to say too many things because he is usually embarrassed. So let me just say that I feel privileged to have shared academic space with him all these years, and I look forward to many more years of collaboration. So let me begin with some basic assumptions. My field is the field of complex numbers, notations. I usually denote by C, comma C, an irreducible nodal curve with a node which I denote by small c. And I assume that the arithmetic genus is greater than or equal to 1. And my g will be a simple, or what is called almost simple, simply connected, fine algebraic group. And I also fix the usual maximal torus boreal inside G, simple roots, and the usual datum. So my question, I have some notation. I'll simply call this boldface A as the power series ring in one variable, or rather the spec of this. And I work with a curve over A. So this surface, I assume, has smooth generic fibers. And at the closed point, which I'll denote by small a here, I assume that it is my curve CC here. So this is the basic object. I also make an assumption that this, as a scheme, is regular. So I'm interested in the problem of looking at degenerations. I mean, a couple of questions. Basically, I'm looking at the degenerations of the modulized space. So on smooth curves, let me recall that if let me say CS here, if CS smooth projective, so this is also a projective morphism. Smooth projective. Then for G reductive, not under these assumptions, even more generally, if you fix what is called a topological type, the modulized space of semistable G bundles on CS with some fixed topological type P, or some type, or maybe some type pi, this was constructed by A. Ramanathan in the mid-70s, somewhere around that. It was shown to be a normal projective variety. And ever since then, it's been studied a lot. Recently, in the past couple of decades, people look at the stack of G bundles. It's more amenable to some of these questions, and then ask whether there is suitable semistability on this stack so that you can construct the so-called coarse moduli and study that. So this construction, of course, is a completely GIT construction, which was done by Ramanathan. He has a notion of semistability, which I'll come to. Okay, so the question that I'm looking at is of whether there is a natural construction of a scheme over A. The crucial questions which one would like to ask is whether it is proper flat. Okay, such that the generic fiber, let me just denote it by M capital K. Capital K will be C T here, whether MK is the Ramanathan space. And since I'm working with simply connected, I don't really need to fix any topological type. This and a certain, I one would like to construct a suitable space over this closed point MA, which is some space of torsors or bundles, torsors on the curve C, C. Semistable, I mean suitable. So this is the basic question, the question of constructing a flat degeneration of this moduli spaces, which are Ramanathan spaces, when the curve degenerates to a simple nodal curve. The same question could be asked for any stable curve, and I believe that the strategy that one wishes to offer here might generalize naturally for more stable curves as well. A few words about the history of this question. So I think I thought it was Seshadri in the case when G equal to GLN, that is, of course, that's not the, my assumptions are simply connected here, but but for the case G equal to GLN, this has been studied for a long time, and it begins with, I mean, I'm not talking about the line model case where this degenerations of these Picards has been studied for a long time and completes with the work of Oda Seshadri and then this work of several others. But in the case of higher rank vector models, Seshadri, I think in his asterisk, he constructs this, he solves this problem by looking at what are called mu semistable torsion-free sheaves on this nodal curve as the limiting entity here with the suitable degree. I mean, you have to fix a rank and degree here for this moduli problem, which is the topological type that I'm talking about here. And so you look at this moduli space of vector bundles on the generic fiber, and then if you look at this moduli space of torsion-free sheaves of rank and degree, which are mu semistable, equivalence classes always, S equivalence classes, then you can construct a proper flat scheme over A. The flatness problem becomes a delicate question. Seshadri uses deformation theory to reduce it to a kind of a Schubert kind of question, a question, matrix theoretic question. And in the rank two, I believe it was solved by Kausik, which Seshadri uses to conclude the flatness. The general case being reduced to some Schubert question, I believe, has been solved by Elizabeth Strickland using some Schubert geometry there. So it's, this is 1982, I think. But Seshadri tells me that Giesecke had a construction of degeneration even before this, although it appeared only in 84. So this is Seshadri. And then Giesecke. This is 1980s, I believe. In the coprime case, if you would work with n equal to 2, degree coprime, degree 1 case, the so-called SU2-1 moduli space. In this case, Giesecke constructed the degeneration, but instead of looking at torsion-free sheaves on this nodal curve, he replaces the nodal curve with what are called semistably equivalent curves, which are, if you, so I'll have the notation, stick to this notation, P the projection, Y the normalization with two marked points. So you take this, the normalization, and attach a P1 to it, but in the rank 2 case, you need to attach two P1s to it. These are what are called semi-stable curves, because the P1 meets it in less than 3 points. So these are semi-stably equivalent in a Giesecke moduli sense. So he looks at certain class of vector bundles. He gives a list of objects, solves them by his notion of Hilbert stability, which is by embedding this curve inside a suitable Grassmannian and restricting the, and looking at the moduli space of such curves, there's a natural notion of Hilbert stability that he defines. And then solves this problem So he's able to get this list of curves because of his semistability, the Hilbert semistability property. And he looks at these vector bundles. And what he gets is a vector bundle on this. Instead of working with torsion-free sheaves, he's looking at a class of vector bundles on these kind of curves. These three curves come because of the rank being 2 here. And they're restricted to the tree of P1s. So I always work with these trees of P1s meeting the normalization here. So this V restricted to the tree. Let me just denote this tree by Rm, a chain of P1s. Chain of P1s, not tree, just a chain of P1s. So restricted here, this is what is called strictly standard. That means it should have, I mean, we know that on these P1s, it's a direct sum of line bundles by Grothendieck. So we want the bundles to be of the type certain number of O's and number of O1s on each of the P1s. And the condition of strictness is that there should be at least one O1 in each of the decompositions. And then further, and with these conditions, and he imposes some notions of stability. He's in fact gives a list of test objects which he wants to check for the stability, and he constructs this modelized spaces. And Giesecke later on in 1984 uses this to solve a conjecture of Newstead and Ramanan on the Chern class of the tangent model, vanishing of higher Chern classes of these tangent models. And he uses this flat degeneration by going to these curves here, and then solves that question. And around 1994 or 95, Faltings wrote a paper where he came back to these questions in a certain stacky manner. And perhaps he looked at the torsion-free modelized space, and then added a couple of more examples where he looked at the orthogonal and the symplectic modelized spaces, because these are vector bundles with natural forms in them. So he could look at them as vector bundles with added structures, tensor structures, and imposed torsion-free sheaves with these added structures, and gave some natural semistability conditions in the usual sense. And he could solve the problem of constructing these flat degenerations. But even in the simplest case of SL2, his methods do not work. Around this time, I think it was Caparasso, and then Pandari Pandey, who look at these Giesecke-like spaces, the Picard case, over MG bar, and this is for the torsion-free modelized spaces over MG bar. Rather than work over a one-parameter family like this, they work over the Deligne-Mumford compactification and construct a relative scheme, which is the Picard at the smooth cases and degenerations of Picard. Yes, I mean I think when I say symplectic, it needs to impose some condition. I don't remember, but if you SL2 in particular, it will be okay. I think perhaps, but not the SLN cases. Yeah, SL2 I think it's okay. Maybe viewed as a symplectic thing. I don't exactly remember. Maybe more generally SLN. Yeah, I don't exactly remember. So this, for over MG bar, these were constructed as relative schemes. This is the torsion-free modelized spaces, generalization of Seshadri's thing, and this is for the Picard. And in Caparasso's case, instead of working with, she works in some sense, she uses the Giesecke picture and works with, for the line bundle case, you need to work with normalization with a single P1, or more generally for other stable curves like this, you'll have to suitably attach P1s for each of these nodes. But a single P1 is enough. And Soon after that, in late 90s, Nagaraj and Seshadri, in a very basic paper, gave a different construction, a different formulation of this Giesecke construction. So this is 1998. They constructed the Giesecke spaces for all nd coprime. Nd coprime allows you to say that stable equal to semistable, which helps him to define the notion of stability for the Giesecke objects. So they define on such a curve a Giesecke bundle to be something which is strictly standard, and the condition that P lower star of V is torsion free plus V is strictly standard. And with this, they construct the moduli space using GIT. The deformation theory for these things, I mean, they need to, the advantage of Giesecke's construction is that the limiting moduli space, unlike here, the deformation theory allows you to prove that it's in fact a divisor, because we're working in a surface case, it's a divisor with normal crossing singularities, which is what allows him to use some Hodge theory and solve the Neustadt-Ramanan conjecture. So they prove that more generally, you can construct these things where this again is Giesecke bundles, and they're able to prove that this moduli space has a divisor with normal crossings, because the deformation theory developed in Giesecke is good enough for the higher rank situation, except that Nagaraj and Seshadri extract the essence of that proof and make it really a usable commodity. Around the same time, Ivan Kaus solved the question in a stacky way. So this is around the same time, there's the stack question without any semistability. And he constructs these moduli stacks and shows that there is a proper flat degeneration. And the flatness question again is a similar question. I mean, there is no, the ingredients are more or less the same. No. For the stack, it didn't require anything. No coprime requirements. So, but let me just say that although in Nagaraj and Seshadri they impose coprimeness, they have some very nice remarks for the non-coprime case as well, and indicate what should be a good strategy. I mean, you have this moduli space of torsion-free sheaves, and you're constructing a relative space for Giesecke bundles on top, and there's a kind of a projective morphism that they show. So with the usual Seshadri formalism, if you have a, you can choose a polarization here, work with the semistability of the torsion-free objects, and then the vertical direction impose an epsilon, small epsilon polarization, and with the relative polarization, the corresponding moduli space is what you should expect as the quotient, as the case for the non-coprime as well, except that you don't have an explicit expression for the semistability, mu semistability. So this was answered by Schmidt in 2004, I think, or 2003, or 4, maybe, where following the Pandari-Pandey thing, he constructs the Giesecke space over this, of course, with the coprimeness condition. No coprimeness condition. And he gives a pure GIT expression for semistability. Not easy to verify, but comes from the GIT. Anyway, this was the situation, and in early 2000, Seshadri had a note in the Neustadt volume where he had some speculations on what should be possible for other G. So this is where the question remained. So, so we wish to look at the question for an abstract G, simple, simply connected group. Yeah. Pardon? That's right. Yes, they prove that it specializes correctly. Yes, only in the coprime case. And they prove that it is a divisor with normal crossings. Because in the coprime case, what happens is, I mean, all deformation theory done at the code scheme, stable equal to semistable allows you to push down the. In the non-coprime case, no normal crossings can be. Yeah. That's what Schmidt does. Schmidt, in fact, solves it for over mg bar for the non-coprime also. Yes, yes. That's right. He proves that. For stable curves, mg bar. Okay, so I come back to my question. And it's kind of technical, so I'll indicate what are the geometric ideas here. So as I said, I work with, pardon?
So in the stacky case, stack specialized.
Moduli space also specializes. This is what Schmidt proves. He constructs the GIT, writes this semi-stability condition, he works together with the Nagaraj Seshadri idea and the Hilbert stability, and constructs the semi-stability on the stack and shows that you have a proper flat morphism. I mean, the Giesecke thing allows you to do these things because the deformation theory is, I mean, already it's there in these proofs. Normal crossings doesn't come for the non-coprime case. Flatness is there. In normal crossing, okay, so I work with my notation, smooth curve. And since I'm interested in constructing the suitable stack, so I work with a curve S, which is basically the same thing, but map is T going to T to the D. I'm looking at the first case of a curve defined over A, and look at the new surface now, which I denote by CS, which is geometrically the same, except that the neighborhood here looks like CXYT by XY minus T to the D, a normal singularity of the AD type. Yeah, I'm assuming that. Let me just start with this and tell you exactly what is the whole game. So let me fix some notations. So let me work with UD as spec. I will call this the ring RD, spec RD, always the completion here. And U upper D, this is the minimal desingularization. And this is a AD type singularity. So this is a quotient of spec of CUV, the formal power series ring, by a cyclic group gamma D. I fix a generator. And I work with the following diagram. I base change this, and I'll just denote this by DD, where DD is D cross UD over UD reduced. I have some notations. I'll call this P, call this map sigma. This is a quotient. So this is the ring RD is actually CUV upper gamma D, the ring of invariants for that. There's a natural action. Zeta is actually acting on zeta dot U, zeta U, and zeta and V is zeta to the D minus 1 of V. And this, you can easily show that this is the ring of invariants for that. So I call this map Q, the projection here, and this as F. So this is my picture. This is the canonical, this quotient. This is A2 hat here, and this is the quotient. So in this picture now, what I do is I look at the following. So let me go, I'm just going to state the objects and tell you what's the kind of solution that we are looking for. So I fix, I'm working with my group G, let me just say locally. So this is, there is an action of the cyclic group here. So I can talk about equivalent principal bundles on this affine space D, okay, gamma D G bundles. And general theory would tell you that such gamma D G bundles come with a representation of gamma D into G. Of course, whatever I'm stating works in the all the ADE cases, at least the starting points of these. So in all these ADE singularities, the Kleinian singularities, you have these finite subgroups of SL2 in this surface case, and you can look at the minimal model here and the quotient action, and you have this diagram there. So this diagram really comes in the work of Gonzalez, Springberg, and Verdier in 1983, I think, or 85, I don't remember, where they study the McKay correspondence and give a geometric description of the McKay correspondence. So you take you fix a gamma D G bundle and look at this so-called adjoint group scheme. Maybe I should have some notation. E is better, script E. An adjoint group scheme, which is the G acting on itself by inner conjugation, and look at the associated group scheme here. This will be what I call a gamma D group scheme. And what I do now is, I look at, so this is all on this D, so I take Q upper star of EG, which is a nice gamma D group scheme on this surface DD. Notice that this UD is the local picture looks like you have this D minus 1 P1s, D minus 1 P1s, and the normalization comes and meets here, and you have some sort of a picture of this guy. So all this is the sitting over the nodal curve here. So I take this Q upper star, this is a gamma D group scheme, and now this is known here that F is finite flat. So since it's finite flat, I can use Grothendieck formalism of the veil restriction of scalars. This. The horizontal map on top. Veil restriction of scalars. And I construct the so-called F lower star of this group scheme, E upper star of EG. And this I denote by, so I also note when I say this, I fix this representation. And general theory would tell you, since I'm fixing a maximal torus, I can by conjugation assume that it is sitting inside the fixed maximal torus. And it's a finite, so home gamma T to T can be identified with the one parameter subgroups of T modulo D times YT. This YT is the co-characters. And so this, if I choose simple roots and express a point of, look at this representation as given by a co-character here, as an element here, it can be expressed as a linear combination of the duals of the simple the alpha I stars for the simple roots. And so there is a bunch of numbers which I call A1A to AL, which following Seshadri and Andre Weil and such people, this is called the local type. In general, if you have, I'm working on the affine space, so this is called the type of this representation. So this representation rho is called of type tau. So I'm fixing the type of this representation, which is this bunch of numbers determined modulo D. And so, pardon? L? L is the rank of this group G. And for this type, I look at this group scheme that I've obtained here, and I call this a gamma D group scheme of type tau. This type is very interesting because it provides you with a point in the so-called Weil alcove. So this is something that comes up in my paper with Seshadri on paraharmonic bundles. So to each point, to each such type, I can associate a point to the so-called Weil alcove here, sitting inside the apartment, the affine apartment, which I can identify with YT tensor R. And so I call this, so what am I doing? Let me repeat. I fix a gamma DG bundle, which is going to be my base point for my study of my torsors or my stack. And I take, look at the associated adjoint group scheme, which is now a gamma D group scheme of some type, which is coming from this. Pull it back and take the push forward, which is the Weyl restriction of scalars, and take the gamma D invariance here. So this is called the invariant direct image of this group scheme. So I look at the invariant direct image, Q upper star of EG, gamma D, and I denote this new group scheme by HG tau. This is a group scheme on my surface, on the minimal, the smooth surface, the regular surface, UD. Okay. This is an example of what I call a two Bruhat-Tits group scheme, or because Bruhat-Tits theory, let me just recall here, is that if you work with a discrete valuation ring, spec A, and the generic point spec K here, the Bruhat-Tits theory looks at certain subgroups of GK, which are called paraharmonic subgroups, parameterized by points of this Weil alcove, and they construct A group schemes, smooth flat group schemes over spec A, which are canonically determined by these paraharmonics, in the sense that the A valued points of these group schemes are precisely these paraharmonics subgroups. These paraharmonic subgroups are examples of what are called bounded subgroups, and they contain the so-called Iwahori subgroup. The Iwahori subgroup is that you take the A-valued points of G and take the evaluation to the K-valued points here, take a Borel, take the inverse image here inside this, and look at GK conjugates of that. Those are precisely the Iwahoris. So a paraharmonic is something following the something which contains an Iwahori. And these for associated to these paraharmonics, you have these group schemes on these spec A's. And of course, they do it in the greatest generality. I mean, they do it for not assuming G simple and things like that. But so these, in my paper with Seshadri, we show that these group schemes or these paraharmonics in the simple case of in the curve case, you can realize it as this kind of invariant direct image construction. So in the case when we have spec B to spec A, where these are both discrete valuation rings, and the map is Z going to some Z to the D, you can take similar group schemes like a constant group scheme here or a group scheme coming from a joint group scheme here, and you can call this map P. You can take the gamma D invariant direct image of these group schemes, and they become, they give these paraharmonic group schemes or Bruhat-Tits group schemes. And conversely, you can recover all such in the complex situation. We're working over complex numbers here. All such Bruhat-Tits group schemes can be recovered as invariant direct images. So these group schemes are, these paraharmonics, associated paraharmonic group, can be expressed in terms of the so-called local automorphisms. I am fixing this bundle E, which is a gamma DG bundle. So you look at this gamma DG equivalent automorphisms of this bundle, and they become the parahorics. These are, you know, I'm looking at a gamma DG bundle of local type tau, and tau gives rise to a point in the Weyl alcove, and you look at the corresponding parahoric P theta tau, and you can prove this, and also prove that all these, so any parahoric in the complex situation comes as these unit groups, or these local automorphism groups, and conversely, and you have this full classification. But now we are looking at a regular surf, two-dimensional local ring here now, with a distinct divisor with normal crossings coming with the configuration here. And this group scheme is a 2BT group scheme in the sense that in this picture here that I drew, I have these P1s. So this group scheme, outside this tree of P1s will restrict. See, these group schemes have a nice property that over spec capital K, GK, at least in the split situation, I can assume it is G cross spec capital K. So the generic fibers is G, and the closed fibers will be some non-reductive group which comes with a large unipotent radical, and which one can write down very precisely. And so what happens here is that in this surface, you have these general over outside this chain of P1s, and this normalization, this group scheme is actually G, and it becomes parahoric at all the height 2 primes coming as generic points of these P1s, as well as the height 1 primes and the height 2 primes coming from these nodes. And each, you can, the given this type tau, you can actually describe this group scheme because it degenerates into a Bruhat-Tits group scheme in this direction and then further. This group scheme along this, at the generic point here of these P1s will be non-reductive of a certain type coming as the closed fiber of a certain Bruhat-Tits group scheme. It will go further down to these nodes into other non-reductive groups coming from other such curves passing through these nodes. So you have a nice group scheme, smooth group scheme, which, and on the other points of the normalization, it will be G elsewhere. That is not, if you look at the, I'm looking at this nodal curve and this picture. So I'm just looking at this neighborhood here. So elsewhere, it will be G.
So sorry, group scheme over what?
Over the surface. So this is, I'm looking at this two-dimensional ring, this minimal model, which is a blow-up of this normal singularity. So it has over this nodal curve, it will have a piece, I'm looking at a small neighborhood here. So it'll have pieces of the normalization, a chain of P1s, and elsewhere it'll be the other ones.
So I'm asking, what's the base?
The base of the group scheme is a two-dimensional regular local ring, is the minimal model, UD, that is the surface, with a chain of P1s and two pieces of the normalizations taken to it, and elsewhere the pieces of the smooth curve. So this is like a regular local ring. And I'm on this smooth surface, I have this group scheme now, which outside the chain of P1s is actually the constant group G. On the normalization at this, except those two points, it is G again. On the marked, on the chain of P1s, it starts degenerating.
Yeah, so are you also saying something about the fiber of this group scheme at a non-closed point of like P6?
Yes, at this group scheme over the nodes and at the generic points of the P1s. At the generic point of the P1, it will turn out to be the closed fiber of a standard Bruhat-Tits group scheme because it's a height 1 prime ideal. You'll have a discrete valuation ring here. The G will degenerate to a certain non-reductive group at the generic point. At the nodes, it'll again be further degenerations. You can prescribe the weights.
At the nodes, it'll be a group scheme over C.
This is a group scheme. It's a flat, smooth group scheme over C.
When you say at the nodes, it's actually a
group. That group is actually a non-reductive group, which is a closed fiber of a certain Bruhat-Tits group scheme.
So at a closed point corresponding to one of the, at a non-closed point corresponding to one of the curves,
yeah,
it's a group scheme over
everywhere it is G. So if you look at the surface here, let me just draw this chain of P1s here. At everywhere else it is G.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a group scheme over this.
What is the statement about the groups?
To non-close point of what? I mean, so I'm having smooth curves here degenerating to this. So I have this curve again here. These are the same smooth curves.
Yeah, so it's a group scheme over that.
Over here, over the surface.
Right. So you seem to be saying something about the specialization of the group scheme to the point of the scheme corresponding to that curve.
Yes.
So what's the statement?
So the statement is you have a group scheme here. You restrict it to the complement of this chain of P1s. It's a constant group scheme with fiber G. You're restricted to the chain. I'm actually telling you what is the closed fibers of this group scheme are at the node as well as the generic points of the chain of P1s. So these are the fibers of this group scheme. So the group scheme here has a certain fiber, let me call it HT at this point, node, let me call it N here, will be a certain G theta N, a closed fiber of a certain Bruhat-Tits group scheme, which will be determined by a smooth curve passing through this node here. Because at the generic points of the smooth curve, it will be G. The group scheme will be a G degenerating in through each of the smooth curves to the node. You can take any generic curve, any small curve passing through the node. And at the generic points, at the Highton prime ideals, this will begin.
So what is it? Can you just say it somewhat explicitly?
Yeah, I can say, I mean, the explicitly means I have to prescribe the weights. So all I'm trying to say is it's a, this is a group, explicitly, a group scheme is prescribed by either the Hopf algebra or the fibers of the group scheme. I'm giving you a very geometric picture, but it has to be prescribed in terms of the A-valued points there. But this is a smooth group scheme, and I can talk about torsors under this. So the bundles, which I'm interested in, are torsors under this group scheme, homogeneous spaces. But right now, I'm looking at the local picture. So I don't know what more I can say about, I mean, yeah. In general, you see, this is the same kind of question that if you have a group scheme, you can describe its closed fiber, you can describe its generic fiber, and that's exactly what I'm doing. I'm describing its closed fibers along a chain of P1s and its generic fiber. And of course, I mean, the group scheme is functorially defined. It's defined as a veil restriction of scalars. So it comes with all its scheme theoretic data. So this is the local picture. Of course, you have to globalize this. So you work with your surface SCS, the projective object, and look at the minimal model layers, which I denote by CDS now, which is the picture that I was drawing there. And then you can do the same construction. So here, instead of my small AD affine space, you have a Dillon-Mumford stack here, which can be constructed, whose coarse moduli will be this surface. And again, you can look at this base change reduced. And this minimal model will be the coarse space for this. So these are Dillon-Mumford stacks. And you can again fix a G torsor, which is a G torsor on this Dillon-Mumford stack, will be given by some local charts at the node here. So this will be, a surface, but it will be a stack here. You'll have to prescribe the local type. So this again, I'll call it a G torsor of local type, tau, given by a representation. So locally, it's just a quotient, as we have worked. So this will be a G torsor here. And the same maps here I can talk about. And I can construct this invariant direct image, Q upper star of EG. I can, when I take the push forward, I'm calling that the invariant direct image. The push forward in the stacky sense. So the problem here is this push forward in the stacky sense cannot be constructed as a group scheme. You'll have to really construct it by a patching argument. So this, I have to be careful here. Let me not state it like this. So outside the node, everything is like a constant group scheme. So you'll have this big projective surface now. So I have this big projective surface, smooth here, and in some sort of a neighborhood here, I've constructed this group scheme. And then there is this constant group scheme outside this. But now we are on a surface, and there is no good descent datum here. So what one ends up getting, with a little bit of technical arguments, is what is called a group algebraic space. So you can actually construct over this minimal surface a group algebraic space of type tau, it won't exist as a group scheme, but it'll have scheme-like points at the height 1 prime ideals of the tree and elsewhere. Yeah. At the height 2 primes, you won't have a scheme structure. So with this, so more generally, you can take any scheme P over this base scheme A, and you can look at the so-called scheme of modifications to define the correct functor, and one can construct this stack, which I'll just denote by Hg tau. This is an Artin stack and proves locally of finite type. These are the stack of torsors under Hg tau. I mean, it takes work, and one can study the deformations of this. So what is the interesting part of this is that one can prove that when the case when G equal to GLN, although I assumed simple, we can still construct these group schemes in the case when G equal to GLN. This stack, coincides with the stack of Giesecke vector bundles on CA of rank n. This is the stack constructed by Kaus. So, and proving this, so the key point here, which I'm missing here, which I didn't mention, in the description of this group scheme, one really uses what is called the McKay correspondence in a very fundamental way. So in the local picture, I told you that on this chain of P1s, you have these weights coming in, and these weights can be prescribed in terms of, so the McKay correspondence, let me just state here, which plays a key role is the following. So I had this A2 to A2 modulo gamma D, and the correspondence tells you that there is a bijective correspondence between irreducible characters of this group gamma, or gamma D more generally, with the irreducible components of the chain of P1s. So let me call this chain of P1s R. So this is my UD here. And these are the non-trivial characters here. And this correspondence is not just like that, it's a very natural correspondence. So to each character, in our simple case, we have only characters of this group gamma G. To each character, I can prescribe a line bundle on this chain of P1s here. And the bijective correspondence is to this character, there is a precise P1 here, which I just denoted by P1 chi. And this line bundle, actually, in this process of pulling back and taking invariant direct image, can be shown to take the value of O1. Elsewhere, it is O. So this is the bijective correspondence. And this is geometrically, one can say more about it in terms of the divisor which meets this P1 transversely there. Using this data, one can then describe this 2BT group scheme, which is a generalization of the standard Bruhat-Tits theory to the two-dimensional setup. And you can say how this scheme of weights degenerates on the Weil alcove. So you look at torsors under this group scheme, and this is my candidate for the Giesecke vector bundles. And one can prove after some serious work of deformation theory that this has flatness and normal crossings at the level of stack. So the next question, which I have how many minutes more? 15 minutes? Okay. So I need to talk about semistability, and this is a basic, there is a difficulty in this semistability question. I'm just giving some general idea as to what's happening here. So we come to the curve. So I work with this nodal curve, and I'm having a principal G bundle here. I'm claiming that, or the theorem that one is proving here is that this stack has the general fiber, which is the stack of G bundles. and this is a compactification of that. I mean, properness is there as a for the thing, but I want the coarse moduli to be separated, so I need some sort of a notion of semistability and stability here. So if you take a G bundle on a nodal curve, it's a question which has been there for a long time that you don't have an intrinsic notion of semistability for this G bundle. So in the case of GLN, you look at, even if you have a vector bundle, you can look at torsion-free subsheaves and talk about the semistability. But for G, there is no Ramanathan-like intrinsic definition, which was one of the problems which has been there, and it comes up in several papers of Friedman, Morgan, and others, where they studied this in the elliptic case also. So, no, it doesn't. So there are several problems here, firstly. So the nodal curve is just like in the characteristic P situation, the tensor product theorem goes false first. Even if you take two semistable vector bundles, the tensor product need not be semistable. So this is the first problem. So there is no way you can work with any functorial Noori kind of story. And the other problem which comes up here is that the real issue is that if you take even a vector bundle, the sub-objects which are torsion-free sheaves do not have an analog. That is, if you work with the principal G bundle, there is no notion of reduction of structure group to some parabolic kind of story here. Because this torsion-free sub-objects cannot be thought of. So if you work with a vector bundle, you can still talk about an extension datum like this and still have notions of semistability. You can talk about the slope semistability of these objects. But if you take a G bundle, the sub-objects, the test objects that you would wish to do for your semistability is not easy or not amenable. So there was some conjectural, very natural questions, definitions which were made which go wrong. Following the Ramanathan thing, you can do the following. You can take a reduction of structure group to a parabolic on the nodal curve minus C. So that's a P bundle. And you can take the associated Lie algebra bundle on EPP. And you can take the Lie algebra bundle of EGG, which is defined on the whole C because E is a G bundle. I'm talking about the principal G objects. The boundary objects for the compactification have to be suitably defined. There, I'm saying that in the notion of semistability of G, already the boundary-like objects will be forced inside. So you look at the associated Lie algebra bundle. So this is a sub-bundle of this on the punctured thing. So you can take the saturation of this, killing the torsion in the quotient. So this is a sub-torsion-free sheaf of this vector bundle. And then one can ask whether this condition, semistability, should say this is less than or equal to 0 or less than 0, a la Ramanathan. And this goes horribly false. So this is wrong. And I've given a counterexample for the GL2, you can show that this goes false. So there is a genuine question, a genuine problem in defining semistability here. And it is this torsor way of looking at it which is going to help here. So I call this following the Indian spiritual traditions, the fourfold aspect. Pardon? It goes wrong. It goes wrong. False even in GLN. Yeah, it coincides. That's what I said. It coincides with the cow stack. You can construct the moduli space also. The fourfold aspect of Giesecke torsors. So there is this group scheme picture, but this group scheme has, if you take this group scheme, you can look at the following simple nodal curve picture itself. I'm writing this nodal curve here, but this exists only as a stack again. So this is the simple, the curve case. This is by Olson, you can construct some root stack so that locally it looks like a quotient here. So here also, the action is by gamma d at the node, the same action. So I'm looking at CUV modulo UV locally. So this is, and the action zeta, zeta bar, and you'll get the corresponding quotient here, which is the nodal curve here. And you can look at the normalization here and the normalization here, and you have the following, it's the same picture here. I'll just denote it by P and sigma here. So on this, you know, when I looked at my group scheme, which was on this big surface, I restrict my Agisaker torsor, which is going to be my limiting object, instead of a torsion-free sheaf, will be a torsor under the group scheme on this Giesecke curve. And I kept working with a gamma d, so there is a natural bound on d, which is going to coming from the underlying structure of the group g, coming from the root datum. So how many d's, what sort of cyclic group gamma d's do you act on? How many d's do you throw in as these p1s in this moduli problem is bounded. You have to prove that also. Anyway, so you look at this group scheme and restrict it to the normalization. You get a parahoric group scheme at these two points, y1 and y2, with what are called conjugate weights. And I say parahoric group scheme again, these are group schemes which are G-like here, everywhere, and here it will be some non-reductive group, so it will be defined by some patching here. Here patching can be done because we are in the dimension 1 case, descent theory works. But so you can construct this group scheme. But this group scheme, if you follow the same strategy, these are like group scheme here, pulled back and constructed by veil restriction of scalars. But these group schemes are what I call balanced plus some lazed group scheme. They come with a descent data. There's an identification because it comes from the node here. There's a descent datum of which is also has to be carried along. That's a complicated datum in terms of some filtrations here. So I call this a lazed group scheme. So this is on the smooth normalization. So this is a normalization with two marked points in two analytic neighborhoods. You have these Bruhat-Tits group scheme with some sort of a descent datum at the closed fibers and identification. So if you look at this group scheme here, I'm looking at torsors under this group scheme, which are so first one sets up a bijection or an identification with torsors under this group scheme here with torsors under this group scheme with the descent datum. So these are called, this will be torsors with some extra datum. So there's a nice way of identifying it on the single curve. But if you want to work in families, you can't work with the normalization because the normalization, there's no flat way you can do it. So you have to work with these big group schemes to solve the flatness question in the stack. So you work with the normalization for these, to understand the points. So you look at this normalization. So this object I denote by a lazed bundle by some EP here. So this object here can be identified in terms of some gamma D, G bundle here. So this, I mean, Narasimhan warned me that I shouldn't say, this is like a McKay correspondence, essentially whatever I'm doing. And at the level of vector bundles or at the level of derived categories, this is essentially the Bridgeland King Reed story. Miles Reed told me this when I met him recently. So you basically pull back a vector bundle and push it forward at the level of K-rings. Gonzalez, Springberg, and Verdier had already done it. And for the two-dimensional case, this was some Kasparov and somebody. And then the three-dimensional case, when you look at subgroups of SL3, so this is a derived category relation. But now we are looking at group schemes and trying to understand torsors under these. So I'm just looking at pull back and push forward here. Push forward, the finite flat case being replaced by the veil restriction of scalars. So you look at this torsor on this normalization with some balanced structure, some descent datum. You come down here, and then you need to look at. So I want to talk about test objects for testing the semistability of this. So test object usually is written in terms of parabolic subgroups, and it's for every one parameter subgroup inside G, I have this so-called parabolic P lambda, and one has to write a suitable slope condition for such things. So to handle that, you need to work with the lazed objects, the gamma DG objects, and there is an idyllic picture here also, which comes in, some gluing data here. So the interesting thing here is that if you just restrict your attention to the union of these two curves, the invariant direct image here of a gamma vector bundle on this nodal curve turns out to be a torsion-free sheaf in this nodal curve here. And that torsion-free sheaf in the local picture allows you to somehow bring in the notion of slow semistability for your lace torsors, and you can define the notion of stability and semistability for these objects, and hence for these Giesecke bundles. And the final upshot is the following theorem. I'm sorry, this is somewhat technical, but I just thought I'll just state. The final theorem is that you can construct, by using this notion of semistability and relating it to a certain moduli space constructed by Schmidt, where you can construct the moduli space MCA of G, which is over A, flat, projective, so that the general fiber is the Ramanathan space, Ramanathan, and the special fibers are the coarse moduli space, let me just denote it by MA, H, SS. This is the coarse space for the stack bun A, H tau that I defined here. There is an open subset of semistable objects, and this will be the coarse space for that. And this construction, the final construction, of course, relies on a GIT. The semistability that I'm talking about here, see, the problem, just to highlight the question here, the issue here, is in Nagaraj, Seshadri, or Schmidt situation, if you look at a Giesecke vector bundle, they have a natural push down, which is a torsion free sheaf. If you have a G bundle or a Giesecke bundle, the concept of a push down as a torsion free object doesn't make sense here. So there is no way of prescribing a torsion free sheaf whose semistability is going to come in here. So that's the reason why you have to do this complicated construction here. So what you get as a semistability here is what I call TF semistability, or the analog of the torsion free semistability, because you are really going to use some local torsion free datum that's coming in here. And then you have to have a vertical semistability. So what I define here is NS, or Nagaraj Seshadri semistability on these torsors. And this has the right coarse construction, and you have a proper flat thing. And this answers. So, and this definition of semistability that I'm giving here is not just for bundles, but also for, more generally, for Giesecke bundles. The usual G bundles are caught inside that. And you have a kind of a full answer to the degeneration problem, as well as the notion of semistability on nodal curves. I think I'll stop with this.
Any questions?
Thank you.